Science Fiction Stories of the Future from the Past. Narrated by Joseph Tabler, a Dusty Tones audiobook in cooperation with Spoken Realms. Copyright 2022. These stories are from the public domain. Read from Project Gutenberg.
The Automatic Maid of All Work, A Possible Tale of the Near Future, by M.L. Campbell. The story was originally published in the Canadian Magazine of Politics, Science, Art, and Literature for July 1893. Yes, I mean to say, an automatic maid of all work invented by my husband, John Matheson. You see, it was this way. The old story of servants, ever since we began housekeeping, we've had every kind, and if we did not get a good one, something would come along to take her off. You know, John has invented lots of things. There's that door spring now. Not much when you look at it, but it brings in quite a little income. He used to say that he was spending his spare time on an automatic maid of all work. Of course, I laughed, and I wished he would, and thought no more of it. Well, the day the last girl left, John announced that the automatic maid of all work was completed, and that he would stay at home next day and show me how to work it. Of course, I didn't believe it. It was quite a queer-looking thing with its long arms, for all the world like one of those old-fashioned windmills you see in pictures of foreign countries. It had a face like one of those 24-hour clocks, only there were no hands. Each number was a sort of electric button. It was run by electricity, you know. The battery was inside. I didn't understand it very well. I never could see into anything in the way of machinery. I never pretend to listen when John tells me about his inventions. The figures, as I said, were buttons, and you just had to connect them with some wires inside. There were a lot of wires, each of some kind of work which would be done at the hour indicated by the button you connected it with. This was handy, so that we would not have to get up in the morning till breakfast time, and would be handy in a lot of ways. "Now look, Fanny," says John, "do try and understand how it works. You see this wire now? I'll connect it with button number 6, and at that hour the maid will light the fire, sweep the kitchen, and then the dining room. Now this button number 7 will be the one to set the alarm to. It will sound for about 10 minutes. I'd sound it now, only it makes a fearful noise. Then the maid will go upstairs to turn down the beds, a convenient arrangement in many ways. Then it will go downstairs, lay the cloth for breakfast, make the tea and toast, bring in the things, and ring the breakfast bell. You'll have to leave all the breakfast things on one shelf, of course, and measure the oatmeal and tea also. We won't set any more buttons tonight. It's just as well to be around at first to see that all goes right. There may be some adjustment necessary." We went to bed then, and it was daylight when I awoke. I was conscious of a peculiar whirring noise, but I hadn't gotten thoroughly awakened when I heard the most awful screams and thumps, and the two boys came running into our room in their night dresses, and after them the automatic maid of all work. By this time I was out of bed, but John sleeps very soundly. He started as the maid jerked the bedclothes down and laid them over the footboard. And he wasn't quick enough. It took him under the arm. It had an awful grip, too, and laid him across the footboard, after giving him a thump or two, as I do the pillows. John had watched me do it and had the thing to perfection. He didn't suppose it would be tried on him, though. He didn't seem quite prepared for such a performance, for he flounced around so that he and the bedclothes, pillows and all, landed in a heap on the floor. By this time the boys had gotten over their fright, having been treated in the same manner, and we all laughed. John can't bear to be laughed at. However, we proceeded to dress after the maid had gone downstairs. I could see John was a little nervous, but he didn't want to show it, so he waited till I was ready. The boys got down first, and we could hear them laughing. "I dare say you'll have to arrange the table a little, Fanny," said John, as we went down. "But that won't be much to do when all the things are on." Well, we went into the dining room, and sure enough the table was set, and pretty well, too, only that the butter dish with the butter was upside down on the table, and the coal scuttle was set at John's place instead of the oatmeal dish. That was because John, who always leaves things in ridiculous places, had left it standing on the back of the table.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.